I'm going to be working on my linear algebra crate today, and what I want to do is implement strides that differ. So basically, if we have a strided array, there can be more than just n bytes between each element. Maybe if I show the code, it will become more obvious. So what I'm doing right now is I'm actually getting this stride, but it's not actually being used, and this is also wrong because it's not accounting for the dimensions of the array. And I think the easiest way to solve this for now is just to have a free function. Stride packed, maybe, that would take in the dimensions of the array and the lm size, which would be a u size, and would return u size comma n, and of course we need the parameter n. Wait, can we actually have const generics in functions? Not sure. Rust const generics in functions, because they are not really associated, right? So I'm really not sure. Oh yes, right, if the feature has been split, but that's not really what I'm looking for. I guess let's just try it, and if it works, size. Okay, so what we want to do is we will have I wonder how we can do this efficiently. Let's just do it inefficiently for now, and we can optimize it later. Stride equals 0 n. Stride of n minus 1, so of course the lm size, and oh right, that's a nice way. For dim, not for index in o dot dot n, stride of that index is equal to the element size. How do I take the nth power in Rust of a float? Rust std float f64, of course. And is that like a power function? Power f. I guess power I is actually fine. Right. Pow i, and we want n minus that index. So it will start at n, and it will end at 1. I think that's exactly what we want, actually. So let's remove that, because like I said, that's one. Stride packed of the dimensions, and let's make this a reference so we don't take ownership of that. And dim, and the lm size is just std mem size of t, right? Because t is the type of value in our array, and of course we can only ever have one value at once. I need to fiddle around with the stream settings a little bit. It's not showing up correctly for me. Unlucky, I guess. Can't do anything about it. Maybe it will work later. It's not really that important. I just wanted to show up on my Discord status. So now we have that stride, but we're not really doing anything with it. I guess for now let's just write a test, because I'm not sure if our implementation actually works. Function stride packed. Let elements. We don't actually need a variable for that. Let's stride equals stride packed of, let's say the error dimensions are 1, 2, 3, 4. So a three-dimensional array. And the, make it a reference. And the element size is 2 bytes. So what we would expect is that, let assert equal try it, and the array should be basically just 2, 8, 4, 2, right? 8, 4, 2. No, that's wrong. That's wrong. But my whole concept was wrong. This one should be 8 bytes because we have 4 in the last dimension, and each of those 4 is 2 bytes. Elements is 4 bytes. Each of those 4 elements is 2 bytes long, so 8 bytes in total. So there are 8 bytes between each column, and if each column is 8 bytes and we have 2 columns, we should have 16 bytes between the indices of the third or first dimension, I guess. But that means my whole implementation up here is wrong. We don't actually need to take the power, that's only for square matrices. Stride of that index is, I guess we want, if index is 0, then we'll want to, actually we don't need to do that if every time, we can just do it once before. And we can initialize this with lm size. Is this bad style? I'm not sure. Honestly, I don't care. I don't care too much. Stride of that index, then we want to start at 1 because we have already assigned. We want to start at 0. And minus 1. And then the stride of that index would actually, we probably want to reverse that range. Actually, is there some idiomatic way to do it in Rust? Rust reverse range. I'm way over engineering this, but I just want to do it clean. No, I don't want a custom range implementation. So it's really just .ref. .ref. Okay. Now, the stride of that index. So the first should be, you want to make it n minus 2 actually, because it has n minus 1 elements. Does it? Yes, it does. Sure. We can test it later. So the stride of that index is something times the stride of that index plus 1. Because the last dimension is the least significant index. And this is the dimension of that index. So if we want to calculate the second to last index, no, this is also index plus one. Right. Yeah, let's just test it. Cargo T stride. And multiple arrays. Errors, sorry. Expected empty, found. Expected zero arguments, supply two arguments. RS24. Is there some semicolon missing? Guess we want to make this function public so we can actually test it in another module. Why does this not work? Show me more errors. Oh, just a syntax error. Oh yes, we're missing closing bracket. But we're still, there's some warning here which I'm just quickly gonna fix. Function defined here. Why is there... Oh! It's... Oh, I should not name the test the same as the function. I guess let's just do test stride packed. By the way, in case you're wondering why you would not want to pack your struct or your array, because of course if it's packed it has the smallest possible size. The reason is that the CPU has like a word size, so it can only load memory from certain addresses into memory and or into registers. And if your elements in your array align perfectly with the word boundaries in the memory, it's actually faster, or you need less instructions to load the memory into the registers. It's really smart stuff. Source slash allocation. Yes, $101. I forgot to import it. Use crate array allocation. What was it called? Stride packed, I think. I have dementia. I forget stuff like that all the time, and it failed. 226. Let's add some debug statements. So 2 is correct, of course, because that's just the element size. Stride of bum equals index. That's probably some really easy way to do this without passing index 3 times, but I'm lazy. Why is it the 0th element? It's not supposed to be the 0th element. I'm supposed to reverse stride. So it should be like, oh, we only have 3 dimensions. So I guess if I'm just do n minus 1, does that just fix it? No, it doesn't. So why does it think, why does it multiply it by 3? Wait, are my test cases just wrong? I think my test cases are just completely wrong. Oh yes, of course, this should be 24. My function is completely right. Okay. So that works now. Yes. And of course it warns me that the field is never red, because like I said, I don't actually use this field for anything. It's just, I guess if I want to implement FFI later, I will need it with like libraries like OpenBLAS. And I do want to use it now. So, when should we use this? For example, if we have like a borrowed array, which I'm also trying to implement right now, which does not own the data, but only contains the references to an actual array, that array might not be a borrow of the complete array. Like I want to be able to create subviews of an array, and in that case the stride would be non-trivial to compute, basically. Like, nah, I'm not gonna show it. It's kind of hard to explain without graphics, but the stride is non-trivial to compute. As like a column would not be n times the element size, right? So I guess I have these really low-level get and unchecked functions. And I think it might actually be smart to just call the get and get unchecked function, also like to call the get mut unchecked functions, the one here, in here, and maybe inline it. Inlining it, that can be done later, but just inline it here, so I in future if I like change this again, I can just change less code. And in the end, it is the same, right? Yes, it is. So I can just do self.get_mutable_unchecked_offset, and the same can be done for the get here, just without the mutable, of course. And that should already work. Let's test it. And it seems to work fine. Now, I want to calculate the index in another way. Like, I wonder what's the fastest way to compute this, and where I should compute it. Because I think right here actually, because offset is the number of elements from the initial, right? So Actually, no. Because if we do that, we would just be doing the calculations again. I think I should do it in this get internal index function, which what it basically does is it takes in an index, a multidimensional index, so like 1, 2, 3, an array of a fixed size. Don't mark all of that. An array of a fixed size, and it will convert it into a u size, so the offset in elements from the initial element in the from the initial pointer, because every array has like this initial pointer, which points to the first element, and all subsequent elements are just computed based on their offset. Offset from dimension indices and stride and array stride. This is a little bit long. Okay. Now, internal index. For axis index, index of axis size. Zip, self team. Now, if I should actually comment, maybe comment this code because it's hard to understand. It's not really that hard to understand. Temporary index is the dimension, the product of all dimensions before it, times the index. Now, this is actually way simpler now that we have the strides, because I can just do index times self dot stride of that axis index, and that should work perfectly. Right, that should just work. And it does not. The fill and the internal index failed. So slash, it's an assertion 261, no 261. All right, we now get the strides in bytes. I think I should no longer work with the offset as an offset like in element sizes, like a times the element size, and rather see it as n bytes. In which case, this should not be a u size array, but maybe make it Boolean so it's really easy. Boolean array 1 element equals 1 byte, and we just fill it with true. It doesn't matter at all for this example, but it just simplifies the stride calculations. Actually, let's just, that's a little bit ugly. Let's make it an U8. So now it should work again. And it does not. And that looks like some pointer magic is going wrong. $2.75. And the get function is broken. Did I modify? Wait, 275. This does not use the unsave function, so it should. Oh, this is bad. This is really bad. This function assumes that the index will be element sizes, and that's simply not the case. So I should really use U8s everywhere I can, and I need to change the documentation because it no longer works the same as it did. To an element at a byte offset. No, that's not the same. Internal. Let's just replace internal element offset with internal byte offset, because it's no longer an offset. Okay. And we can remove that line here. And this is really clean, actually. That's now way, this line is way cleaner than what we had before. I really like it. So everything should work now. And it does. Beautiful. So if I now have an array whose strides are non-packed, for example, is there an easy way to get the CPU type in Rust? Rust get CPU word size. If architecture is 32 or 64 bit. Target pointer width seems like a likely solution. Which should correspond. AVR chips. AVR chips have 16-bit pointers, but are 8-bit. Okay. AVR chips sound really old. AVR chips. Microchip. I'm sorry, this is all in German. I can turn the English version. By Atmel, acquired by Microchip in our Harvard architect. Yeah, this is exotic stuff. We don't need to care about that. This is probably the best solution. Just define a constant in the allocation. Const word size equals 64. Let's make it 8 because it's 8 byte. Word size equals 4 bytes. Beautiful. So let's have a stride optimized function, or rather stride, I guess, stride it. It's actually like pretty similar to that function, so let me just copy that. Stride packed. Stride it, and what it does is it align array elements to word boundaries so the CPU can load faster. Using less instructions is not necessarily faster. Instructions. pack array elements as tight as possible into one continuous block. This might lead to inefficiencies with array alignment. See stride. Okay. So the last element should still remain the element size. And no, it should actually not remain the element size, because we want to pad the element size to the next word boundary. So we don't want to use the element size, we want to create a variable like padded size equal to this is one of those things which are really easy to talk about, but it's hard to like, actually that one up here should be 32. Okay, how do I like get the next larger multiple of 32? Or of the word size, rather. I'm sure there's some fancy command for this. Get next largest multiple of n. I guess not. I guess I can just code it myself. It's really easy. I have the word size. Okay, I have the element size. I want to divide that by the word size. I want to round that up, and I want to by the word size. Right. And now I just want to use padded size instead of the word size. Actually, can I easily like test this? Because I won't know which target architecture I'll be testing on. I guess the constant will remain the same. Stride it. So same element sizes, except now we have a padded element size of, no, this is non-trivial to test. There is no like easy way to test this. I wonder what I think, can I just leave this like untested? Maybe not untested, but to do at actual test. Okay. So now, for now, we just make sure the function doesn't panic given reasonable inputs. Okay, so that's actually pretty good. I want to make sure I got dash dash no depths dash dash open. I want to make sure provide a type for this item. Oh yes, right. I want to make sure I get that one intradoc link right that I added. Is there even, there's not even public documentation, right? Because that's not a public module. Missing documentation for a module. Right, I have. Yes. How do you do that again? Array device. I've got. I told Clippy that I want each module documented, and if I forget about it, this is really annoying. If I forget about it, the build should fail, which is what just happened. Stride packed and stride strided. Right? And that link was what I was talking about and seems to work fine, honestly. How long have I been streaming for? Just about like half an hour. Seems good. Nice. Anything else I wanted to? Because this is basically what I wanted to do. Alright, that borrowed array is private. Maybe I can try to implement this now, which might honestly go horribly wrong, because I gotta admit I never actually used lifetimes in Rust before. Like I used them a tiny bit, but basically never did anything really complicated using them. Okay, so let's just make a new function at the bottom of this imply. Oh right, I have this borrow function signature defined already. That should return a borrowed array. And these are like the corner indices. So let's just start by calculating the dimensions, I guess. Actually, this should all be, these should all be references. We do not need ownership of these variables. It's completely unnecessary and just moves memory around. Let's borrow. So the dimensions of the borrowed array, we will assume that i1 is smaller or equal than i2. Actually, let's assert for that. Assert i1.zip reference to i2 dot, not sure if that's right, dot all a b, and we want to make sure that a is less or equal than b. This is, I don't think that will work, but Cargo will tell me if it won't, or the Rust compiler will tell me. So the borrow dims will just be i1.zip i2 dot for dot map, and we want to map a b to a minus, no, to b minus a. Yep, and we want to collect that into a vec. Unimplemented Check if it works. Yes, the right expected named lifetime parameter. That's what I was talking about. I've never really played around with like these lifetimes. And I know what they do, but I also know that it's really hard to get them right. And the problem is we are working on raw memory, so I don't know if it will just be that simple. How would we actually get a pointer? We can think about that later. And we need semicolons on line 88. 188. So this should be a semicolon. And of course the borrowed array also has the same generics, namely t, n. Now we are just missing the lifetime parameters. Actually, maybe let's do it in an unsafe way for now, because there are two huge challenges to implementing borrowed arrays, and one is the lifetime parameters, so making sure that the compiler restrictions are enforced, and the other big one is that striding stuff I talked about earlier. And I think I want to do that first and don't worry about lifetimes for now. The compiler actually won't complain because, like I said, we are operating on raw memory. So it does not really have a clue what's going on. We can just change this to a pointer to mut t and it should be all fine, and we get different errors. And because these are references, we can now just zip them directly. No worries, references can be copied easily. Dot seal. Why is that in u size? Huh. We are dividing. Oh, right, of course. We can just do integer division, though. Oh, much rather. We can actually just do plus one. But that's bad. That's bad. That's bad. That's bad. I wonder if there's any useful function, Rust std in usize, that will help me do this. Because I can't do integer division, because if the element size is a multiple of the word size and I then do integer division and I just add one, I will actually waste space completely unnecessarily. Someone is pinging me on Discord. Okay, so we have a lot of checked functions. That's not important. That's not important. Is power of 2? Nope. Leading ones? Nope. Log. Next power of 2. I want that. No, can't use that. Can't use that. Swap bytes. trailing zeros, trailing ones, wrapping next power of 2. But I don't need the next power of 2. I need the next multiple of a number. That multiple is a power of 2, though. That's for sure. Yeah, I don't think there's an easy way to do this. Like a clean way. The thing is, I don't want to overcomplicate it. And that's exactly what I'm doing right now. What does that do? Returning none if results. Oh. So it's like checked remainder. Returning none. Oh, there. That's a clean way to do it. Actually, no. Not clean at all. Yeah, no, let's just... I can add a to-do. To-do. Like this. Or rather, clean this up. And we will do integer division. And then let add equals. This is really stupid now. No, I've worked on this for way too long. I should not. If elms size dot rem word size double equals 0. We don't want to add anything else, we want to add 1. This is a really stupid way of doing it. Okay. Should work now. And I forgot about that plus 23 and that one here, right? No, we want to keep that bracket. Okay. Dot rem. Location.rs use std ops rem. I really need to think of a better way of doing it, but I can't right now. Expected an array, no method named all. Of course I want to make it an iterator. Array.rs 189.iter expected an array found useSize. But that's not the line I edited just now, right? No, it's not. And this will then be a vec of u size. Missing documentation. Create a view of the array containing references to the original data. Data must be borrowed in rectangular shape. Panics. This function will panic if any of the indices, in I1 are larger than the indices in I2. That's because I1 represents the lower bound and I2 represents the upper bound. Note that it is allowed for the lower bound to equal the upper bound. Okay, all good now. Wait, I'm not actually... Oh, of course. I just broke the entire allocation system. Because I don't actually want to remove that. I wanna do it like that. Right. So, I've got the dimensions of the borrowed array. Now I want the stride. Now let's think about this. Last dim stride will equal the borrowed array's last stride. Maybe I can auto imply some kind of array trait for the borrowed array, because of course I want to have all the functions like size, num elements, dot and stuff like that for the borrowed array as well as the actual array itself. Maybe I can do that via dereferencing. Another thing I've never really played around with, but I'm sure it's possible. So, by the way, if you're watching this live on Twitch, I posted the link to my Git repository in the chat at the start of the stream. If you're watching this on YouTube, yeah, I'll upload it later and add the link in the description. Last dim stride will equal the borrowed array's last stride. Now, if the original array, let's define some variables here, original array A, B, C, basically capital letters, and the new, or rather the borrowed array, will go from A, B, C to A star. Let's not use a star for that. A, no, that's what's fine. B and C. Now, the stride of the borrowed array between the columns. Actually, will this array just have the same strides overall and just different dimensions? Was everything that I just did completely useless? Because I think that's actually the case. Now that I actually think about it, I think the stride of the borrowed array is the exact same as the stride of the original array. At least for this second dimension, and the third one is kinda hard to visualize in your head. I might have to look up some math stuff for that. Yeah. I think it's actually equal. To do is the borrowed array stride equal to the original array stride? Because that would actually make a lot of sense. It's only the size that is different. The stride is the same. Yes, of course the stride is the same. We are still like referencing the exact same memory. It makes complete sense. Yeah. So I guess that to-do can just be taken off right now. So now let's just construct a borrowed array. We need a pointer, which will just be a pointer to the i-oneth element. Because that's its starting size. Now how do I get a pointer? Of course I can just get the internal index. self.pointer.add self.get underscore get internal index for i1. Then the dim will of course equal the borrowed dims, and the stride will just be self.stride.clone. Let's add an empty line here because that's an assert. Actually, will it be a problem? Yes, yes, it would be a problem if i1 was larger than i2, because then we would have negative dimensions and there's just no telling how that would mess my code up. Because of course, oh right, we have u size, so it would just instantly panic, because Rust does that if you try to subtract with an underflow. It would just instantly panic, but it would not provide any kind of useful error message, and because of that I think we should keep this assert in for now. Yeah, definitely. So let's just make sure that the code works. And of course it doesn't. We've got the internal index. Maybe I should add an get internal index unchecked function. No, actually we don't check it before, so that would be stupid. So I should just unwrap it, I guess. Like, do I want to return a result is the question. The borrow function expected u size. Why does this stride expect a u size? Oh right, it's still an old implementation from the old stride system in here. Of course, this one, I actually want to copy the documentation as well, should just be the same. So that's fixed. Then name error in line 202. Self borrowed underscore, right, it's borrow dims, that's fixed as well. Now that internal index function, that should take a reference as well. I need to stop taking things by with ownership. Line 200. I actually need to change the internal index function. Right, because the index should not be an array. It can be an array. It can't be an array, actually. But that doesn't matter, because we can just... Like, I think the compiler will figure out itself when to drop stuff. And there's no reason... Right, same issues right here. Let's see if that improved anything. Right, we only have two arrows. How can I I can't make an vec into an array because its size is unknown at compile time, of course. Let's just care about the other arrow for now. Now, if the indices are out of range, actually, I should just return a result. That's result, and then a question mark. Nope. And I don't have anyhow in here, is it? I don't use anyhow in this crate? Right, I don't use anyhow. Okay, I guess. No anyhow. It's line 200 still. So I have this custom error type, which I do using like this error. Call WQ. Nope. Cargo C. And we get... Oh right, I need to wrap it in. Okay. That's a mistake I make every single time. I always forget that. For fuck's sake. Okay, and... Right, so only this arrow is left. How can I fix it? Is there like an array zip function now in stable Rust? I think since the last release, like 1.56 or something like that. Rust array map array zip. I'm pretty sure these are both available on stable. It wouldn't be a problem if it's not stable anyway, because I am using nightly Rust array map. Okay, I guess. Well, anyway, I think this is where I'm going to end it for today. So, might stream tomorrow again. Yeah. See ya.